100.7 The Buzz. KQBC Seattle.
LoveLine is meant for an adult audience.
LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised. Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
LoveLine, coast to coast.
Yep, it is LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number 310-854-4455. Dr. Drew is a board-certified physician, an addiction medicine specialist. Tomorrow night, Everclear will be on the show. It'll be good to see those guys. Drew, I'll enjoy watching you dance when you talk to Art about missing his wedding.
Completely missing him.
And not even calling. Mm. Tonight we have Valerie Rae Miller and Richard Gunn, both from Dark Angel, the big hit on Fox, Tuesday nights, 9 o'clock. And I would say one of the, well, maybe I'd say the biggest hit of the new fall lineup. Wouldn't you guys say that?
I definitely have to agree with you.
Oh, that's
kicking
good.
Butt.
Yeah, that's nice. And this is, what's his name? He did the Titanic that did this.
Cameron.
James
Mannheim.
Cameron.
Well, Cameron.
James Cameron. And is he, now what did he do? Did he write the pilot? Did he come up with it? Or how involved is he?
Yeah, he co-wrote the pilot. And he oversees a lot of production aspects on the show.
Did he cast you guys, or was he involved with that?
Yeah,
he had
definitely
a hand in
involved.
That. Yeah, he had he and his partner Charles Eagley were the main people that cast it.
So he's around. He's not just put his name on it and walked away.
No, he's there. Yeah, he's definitely around.
He has a huge
like
input.
You did that with that breakfast cereal in the mid-90s, where the Drew Pops or something.
The Post,
Drew Pops,
yeah.
Doc Pops. Right? You just put your name on it, walked away, and there's eight kids died.
Yeah, but what could he do with the breakfast cereal?
Yeah, it's true. What's he supposed to do?
Oversee production.
Go down to Battle Creek, Michigan, and stuff it in a box? You're right. Very good point, Richard. You found a friend in Richard over here.
Finally, somebody defend me.
Valerie Rae Miller is also going to be found on one Saturday morning.
Yeah,
that's that ABC kids show. I think I have a cartoon that's on that one Saturday morning.
What's your cartoon?
Is it Buzz Lightyear? Is that on one Saturday morning?
It's on ABC.
Actually, you know what? It is on our lineup. It's on before the actual time slot that I'm in. But that's all the whole morning. It's called one Saturday morning.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we got that going.
Yeah. Yeah, we got a connection going here, baby.
Yeah, that's huge. That's going to carry us for the next 12 to 13
minutes. Yeah.
I go 12, 13.
Okay.
So tell us about your character on the show. Drew and I have never seen the show because we leave for work when the show is on every night. At least in theory, we do.
Yeah. No, I do.
Yeah, Drew does. I'm running. I'm scrambling to leave. So we've not yet seen the show. Of course, it aired tonight.
Yep.
But tell us about your character, Valerie.
Well, you guys are big ballers. First of all, I need to tell you, you need to get a VCR.
Yeah.
Mm. Well, all right.
I've got TiVo.
Yeah. Well, you're high class, man.
But I have TiVo.
You're going into the
I have no
future.
Excuse.
Yeah, mine only records porn.
Oh.
Yes.
Oh,
no, wait a minute.
Yeah, yeah, I'm familiar with the VCR.
No, I'm wrong. It only plays porn. It will record anything, but I have no way of watching that.
Because you have trouble reaching the controls with all the calluses on your hands.
Oh.
Oh.
Everybody's
going to be in. All right, but back to my character.
Yeah, you're a lesbian, right?
Yeah.
Nice.
And I'm a quiet, shy person in real life, so it's really quite a stretch for me. She's kind of feisty. And she's pretty much the life of the party.
What did the ABC people think about you going over to Fox and playing a big lesbo?
You know, I mean, I don't know how big she is. She's about 5'5", 5'6".
It's the Disney people.
Big
there,
about
you
that
go. There you go.
It's Disney.
Yeah, you're doing
you
one
go.
Saturday morning. I mean, the kids are going, Mommy, that's the lesbian from the show where they kill.
Well, you know what's funny, actually? I look totally different.
Yeah.
It's like a people don't usually even put it together.
No, the kids know. The kids know.
You would think that, but yeah. I can walk around and people, even when I look exactly the same as the character on one Saturday morning, I can walk into a store and little kids will stare at me forever and they go, "You look just like that girl on one Saturday morning." But I don't really look that much like either character.
Kids do that because they think people on TV live inside the TV.
Right, exactly.
Drew's kids are pretty freaked when they see him, right?
Yeah.
Although they've never... Do they watch Extra? What are you on now, Drew? Do you on TV? Do you have a show?
No.
Okay, very well. And Richard, let's talk about your character.
Well, first of all, I have to say, I used to think that people lived inside the TV when I was a kid.
Right.
So I can
you
can,
told
I can
you
verify
the truth
that.
Last month.
I can verify that. Yeah, I'm telling about Valerie. That's what I thought. No, my character's my character's name is Sketchy. He's kind of a
Sketchy dude.
Screws up a lot. Yeah, yeah. Guy screws up a lot. He's kind of looking for an angle, but right. he's not a malicious person. He's just not out to really get anybody. He's just trying to get by in this post-apocalyptic world.
It's so his parents didn't name him Sketchy, though. His friends did via his actions, right?
Yeah. His name's Calvin.
Right.
All of our names are like that. All of our names are kind of symbolic of a personality or a character trait. Mm-hmm. I'm original Cindy.
Oh, I see. You're not that lesbian.
Lesbian.
Rachel?
Yeah.
You're 33. What's up?
I have a question. I'm on Paxil, and I was wondering if Viagra would help with the sexual side effects.
The side effect where you lose your sex drive entirely?
Yeah.
What's that?
Oh, and the loss of sensation, too, like very hard to reach orgasm.
Yeah. Does sex kind of seem doesn't even make sense to you at some point?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Totally.
Yeah, women they shut down in these SSRIs. It's like sex is like what are they doing? They're touching. Why are they doing that?
Can I ask something?
Hmm. How long have you been on it?
I've been on Paxil for 2 years, but I was on Prozac like 7 years prior to that.
Oh. Yeah, Prozac is even worse sometimes.
Yeah. How about kickstarting her libido?
Well,
how
Rachel.
Do you do that?
Rachel, sometimes adding Wellbutrin will do it, okay?
I did. They did do that, mm-hmm. And I just had so many side effects on it.
Headache and whatnot?
Oh, gosh. And then I also I was kind of aggressive.
Yeah. How about switching over to Cerazone?
I haven't tried that.
That or Remeron. Those don't have the sexual side effects.
All right, but why don't you let her take the... what you want to take?
Viagra.
Oh, the Viagra, yeah.
Viagra, some people have suggested that that's useful, but it's really no science to base that on.
Yeah, but
yet.
You know women. You give them a sugar pill and tell them it's going to make their boobs bigger and their ass smaller, and they gobble it right up.
Not like men. Men are so smart. Men don't even read the package to know what it's supposed to do.
Right, but that's why we don't believe it. We're skeptics. I'm saying if you gave her Viagra and you waited, if you gave her a diamond from a Lucky Charms box... One of the blue diamonds, and I think
Adam,
is that what the Viagra says? I know, but if I gave her one of these, if I gave her one of these blue diamonds from the Lucky Charms box,
no,
and I said,
come
"This
on.
Is
it's the crescent moon."
No, I'm going with the blue diamond, you retard, because that's what Viagra looks like.
I see.
Oh,
I got
for
it.
Christ's sake!
How did you know that's what it looked
Viagra,
like?
Right?
Never
right?
occurred to me you knew what Viagra looked like. How do you know what Viagra looks
blue
like?
Blue diamonds, by the way, they look like a little...
Now it's twitching. Look at the leg. Look at the leg.
First off, how dare you insinuate that I'm hooked on Viagra?
I don't know how the hell you know what it looks
and now
like.
It's unhooked.
No. The Viagra has been... It's been a deluge of Viagra pictures in the media.
Not pill
and
pictures.
All over the place.
Exactly.
That
kind of
works. With the porno.
Anderson, did
right?
you...
Yeah.
Oh, for Christ's sake. And did you know it was a blue diamond-shaped pill?
Only because you were telling me about it earlier.
Oh.
I see the smoke.
Yeah, when you were blowing me.
Hey, now.
Okay. Listen.
I'm here if you want to share anything with me, tell the lesbian.
How dare everyone. Listen, I'm gonna throw it to the peanut gallery. Do you guys know what Viagra looks like?
Peter, how the hell do you know what Viagra looks like?
He's just nodding.
He's taking it.
Yeah.
Okay, all right. That's
oh, he's taking it.
Yeah.
Oh,
taking
okay.
one?
Well, you're not helping my case at all. I don't know. I've seen a picture of it 1,000 times on
just that one
on
picture.
That television.
I prescribed it 1,000 times. I barely know what it looks like.
Everyone knows a Viagra is that blue diamond
what
shape.
What does Paxil look like?
I don't know.
What does Prozac look like?
Let me explain something.
I mean,
well, Prozac, I'm going is Prozac white. Is. White. Is it like hexagon or is it
into capsules? Yellow and green.
Capsule. Okay, look here. I've made my point. Touche. Here's what I'm saying. None of these other drugs have been labeled, you know, first off, they're not about sex, so there's not all the media hype around these things. They didn't come out a year ago, and the media was a buzz about these things.
No buzz about Prozac in the media?
They were showing pictures. Yeah, but it's not exciting or titillating
exactly,
to show a picture.
Exactly, it's an easy sell because it's about sex.
Right.
It's something that
right.
affects
right.
sex.
I've seen the picture of a million times. So the point is if I handed her a blue diamond... from the Lucky Charms box and told her 20 minutes later, you know, you can feel it, can't you, baby? I mean, you're getting moist, right? She'd probably say, yeah, I feel a little tingly down there. Then we can get it on. Or I'd have the leprechaun banger. The point is she should take the Viagra. I bet it would kickstart her. May not be a good long-term thing. No, Viagra, I bet it'd be good for one night.
But people, yes, it would probably would. That's true.
All right. Alex?
Hello?
You're 16.
Yeah, I just want to say you guys are the best. And I have a question for Dr. Drew.
Mm-hmm.
All right, every time I ejaculate, I still have an erection. I don't know if that's normal.
For 16.
Exactly.
Yeah.
God damn it, that's normal.
Right.
That's something to be proud of.
Yeah, that's good for you, man.
In another few years, you'll be praying for that.
No.
How long
wouldn't bother praying.
How long does it stay around?
For like 10 or 15 minutes.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah?
You should brag about that.
Wait a minute, how tall are you, baby?
5'11".
Hold on. No.
16. Listen, Valerie's on a hit show. She's got to go out with celebrity types now.
16-year-old
boys. All right, Alex, yes.
You're fine.
All right, thanks.
Wow. Do we really need to answer that question?
The
erection stays around.
You just wanted to brag.
It's 16. Your penis is saying to your scrotum, hey, let's go. I mean, I'm still up.
At 16, everything you want to know, is it normal? Whatever you're doing,
right.
You got to know that it's normal, whatever it is. Nothing. Everything's new and different.
Katie?
Uh-huh. Okay.
I was the opposite. I was peeing on my friends thinking everyone must do this.
Katie, don't listen to this.
It turns out
don't lose your train of thought.
Is this normal?
What's going on? I didn't even question it. I was like, wonder why everyone else isn't peeing on their friends at the exact same time I'm doing it. Katie, 14, what's up?
Yeah, I had a question about my mom's heroin addiction.
Mm-hmm.
Great. She's 38, and she's been on heroin for the past 20 years.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
Off and on. And I have a youngest brother. He's 5, and she was on heroin when she was pregnant with him.
Mm-hmm.
Is that, like, dangerous for when he gets older? Can he, like, have, like, maybe a chance of getting hooked on a drug? Or
no, it's no more, really, than you.
Mm-hmm.
Both of you are at risk. It's about 50-50 for each of you that you'd have the gene for addiction. And then being raised in an addictive family seems to add risk to the situation.
Yeah, but you see, you got that alcoholic gene which can go in any direction. But even if your mom had kicked heroin 5 years before you or your brother came around, you'd still have the same chance.
No, not the same. You'd still have the same biological chance.
Yeah, the same biological chance.
Being reared by a heroin-addicted mother creates the kind of emotional disturbances that put people at added
she's
risk.
She's not asking that, although we should address that. But she's saying, does he have some trace of heroin coursing through his veins somewhere?
No. The deal with heroin during pregnancy is it puts the whole pregnancy at risk, and oftentimes they abort spontaneously. It's a mess. But once they get through the pregnancy, it's nothing special.
Turns out it's good for the kid.
Provided they're HIV negative, hepatitis C negative, that kind
of thing. Okay, and I have another question. My sister, she's 18, and pregnant. She's 8 months pregnant.
How many kids do junkies have these days?
I have 5 kids in my family.
Oh, I'd really
did
like...
Did we talk to her last night?
I'd like to put just a little bit of air in that mother year syringe and put her down.
Whoa.
Just put her right down in the ground.
We're all really great kids, though. We have a nice family. Well, except for my mom, but she's gone.
Yeah.
We're Jehovah's Witnesses, actually.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Who's Jehovah's Witness?
My family.
Was she? Was your mom took
no,
off?
No, my mom's not, no. We just recently came in, like, about 3 years ago. Mom's been gone for, like, 8 years, maybe.
Wow.
Oh, boy. Do you have a stepmom?
Huh?
You have a stepmom?
No.
So what happened with your sister? You were telling us about your 18-year-old sister.
Yeah, she kind of, accidentally, in a way, got pregnant, and she's 18.
Oops.
Yeah.
Slipped and fell.
Well, under the wrong circumstances. And she still lives with our family and stuff, and she's 8 months pregnant, and the guy who, impregnated her, he has ADD. Is that going to affect the baby?
About the same as with addiction. In fact, ADD... I will predict, and that young fellow probably is addiction,
mm-hmm.
and not just ADD. So it's really addiction gene again we're talking about.
Wait a minute, are they married?
No.
What about Jehovah?
Yeah, I know. She met the guy through my mom's drug recovery program.
I see. Hey, Katie?
Yeah?
Here's what I'm thinking. Where are you calling from?
California, Stockton.
I see. You need to move. First off, Stockton, while technically being in California, I don't look at it as part of California.
Mm-hmm.
That's number one.
Okay.
There, one day I'll give you a list of the places that are
really
only geographically, but emotionally, they're not part of California.
Spiritually separate.
When people are like, you know, in the Midwest and it's snowing, they're talking about the California lifestyle, they're not picturing junkies in Stockton.
Or weed.
I can guarantee you.
Is Orange County in California?
It's right on the outskirts. Okay. Yeah, it's close. Yeah, it's right there. Once in a while, some of those
people are thinking about
white
beaches.
People get over the border and they make it into L.A. proper. But
so she's supposed to.
Katie, here's what you need to
move.
Do.
Okay.
You know, your nephew's got a 50-50 chance of being ADD. Your sister's got a 50. Everyone's got a 50-50 chance. That all adds up to about 250%.
Uh-huh.
You got to get out of there.
Okay.
Just turn 18. Do well in school and go far away to college.
Okay.
Because even if everyone doesn't become what they could be, it's still a bad family.
Mm-hmm.
That's a bunch of jokers. You got a good head on your shoulders, and you got to use your brain, go to school, and get some scholarship, and get out of there.
Okay.
All right?
I will.
All right. Is there a Kids of Junkie scholarship? Because to me, that trumps any color, any religion, any race. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
As far as like, it's like, well, you're half Cherokee. Wait a minute, Tonto. Hold on. Get out of the way. My mom's a junkie. Okay. You get free ride.
You know what? I'm from a really rough background. And what it does for you is it makes you a much stronger person. And it sounds like people say it, and you just say it, and you say it, and you say it. But I've been through so much stuff in my lifetime. And not that I would wish to have that happen, but since it did, I mean, just the way I deal with life on a daily basis is, you know, really good for me.
But
not too much ruffles my feather. So, I mean, you have that going for you.
But it makes a few people stronger, and they, you know, host Saturday morning shows and get land rolls on Dark Angel. But the other 98% of them just turn into junkies themselves.
I think
for the most part.
I don't necessarily...
Statistically, that's true.
Statistically, yeah. I mean...
But it's one of those things where people don't really... Like, you don't really hear that other people have made it out. And so if you don't know any better, you're in the environment that you're in. Like you said, for her to leave, okay, so leave. I agree with you with that. As long as you get yourself and you know that there's something else that you can do and you truly believe it, then you've already conquered your worst enemy.
I'm not so worried about her because she's 14.
Right.
She's calling the show.
She's
asking the right questions.
Right.
She's got four or five other brothers and sisters. That'll be the other 80 or 90%
right.
that didn't.
But she's
get
definitely
out.
One of those people that could be in the 10%.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I wish it was that high, by the way. Yeah.
But
Richard,
it can be.
I was just gonna say, if she stays in the house, she'll probably follow in the rest of their footsteps, like you're saying. She
right.
Well, you wind up supporting a bunch of people.
Right. No. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Get out of there. No forwarding address, John.
Oh, yes. Hey.
You're 15. What's up?
I just want to say, hey, both of you guys, Dr. Drew and Am. You guys rock. Listen to you guys almost every day.
Thanks.
And I have a question for Dr. Drew. I recently started going down my girlfriend. I want to know, like, what specifically can I catch?
Anything. Anything you can name.
You need to catch a school bus if you're 15.
How about scurvy or malaria?
Any sexually transmitted disease you can name, you can get through oral sex.
Isn't it true that you can catch, a man can catch HIV easier from performing cunnilingus than from having penetration?
I don't know if that's true, but I'm behind it 110%.
You can get a yeast infection in your throat.
Not been proven yet, but
a guy in college had that. It was so gross.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that thrush?
Yeah.
Yeah,
how would you not know? Isn't there something that should tip you off?
He got
something that's wrong?
He got them?
Yeah.
There's something else going on.
Valerie, let me tell you something. If you're going down on a chick with a yeast infection...
That's what I'm saying. You should know, right?
You don't have the keenest...
That's what they told me.
The guy had a yeast infection?
That's what all of his friends said.
No.
All of his friends?
No.
No, I don't... I mean, I know him, but
the
I...
You can get oral thrush, but...
Fraternity?
This means there's something wrong with your immune system.
No, I wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah.
He was kind of junky.
Yeah.
All right. Hey, what college? Is this junior college?
No.
Regular college?
Yeah, regular college.
What college you go to?
North Texas.
No, I never heard of that. Sorry. Have you ever heard of that one? We haven't been there?
We haven't been there.
Sorry. No. You have to pick another one. All right, hey, John, you could get what you could, whatever you can get.
Just be your, how old's your girlfriend?
She's 15 also.
Is she a virgin?
Yeah.
Okay, how is it that you would get an STD from someone who's never had sex?
Good point.
The whole definition of sexually transmitted.
Oh, well, airborne,
right in the name.
Yeah. Airborne herpes. You never heard of that?
I am, but I'm not sure she is.
You gotta swat those things.
Oh, you know
out
she's
here.
A virgin. I see.
Yeah, I'm a virgin.
Well, you know you're not. You don't have a trained eye, and even a trained eye, most of the stuff you can't see. So it's part of the risk of getting sexually active. If you
right.
want to reduce your risk, get a dental dam.
No, he's not going to do that. She's 15. She's fine. Her experience is limited, if she has any at all. You're fine, John.
Give
me
a
big green light to get down there and give her an opportunity to fake an orgasm while you're giving her oral sex.
Interrogator, John.
Yeah, she'll be happy. Don't worry.
All right, John.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Jesus, thank God I never went down on anyone at 15. Would have been a mess. I would have been eating.
Ew.
I wouldn't know what to do. I'd be cracking jokes. You're holding up stuff. You want a lifesaver?
Ew.
I would have
relish.
I would have been checking every 2 minutes. How's that? Is it all right? All right. I'll be in the vagina if you need me.
Ew, Drew. Drew is brushing through his hair.
Well, you don't mind if I eat while I'm thumbing you, do you?
Oh.
Yeah. I always thought the hole was at the top part, but it's down and around the bottom. Is everyone that way or is that... Okay. Oh, stop talking? Okay. Yeah. No, we should shut the light. You're right. Oh, God.
No, we're on break.
What,
here.
We're on break?
I make a phone call.
Yeah, Drew's got to make... Oh,
I do. I get paged twice. Three times here.
How dare they? Yeah. What? Who paged
I don't know. To find out.
Well, hold on. Let me sell this call. Philip?
Yeah.
Drew, don't call people back so fast. It makes them think you're going to call back fast next time.
I know, but it's an emergency line.
Yeah. How many of those emergencies are actual emergencies?
1 out of 10.
10?
You got statistics, don't you?
1 out of 10 or 1 out of 20 with you?
Drew, do you just make these up, or do you really have them somewhere?
This is ballpark.
I've heard him page.
So who did this study?
No, this is just me.
Oh, okay.
What happens
in general?
To me.
Okay.
I've heard you page 1,000 times. Never been anything serious with anyone under 90. Philip?
Yeah.
You're 25.
Yes.
All right. You have one testicle?
No, I have one swollen testicle.
Oh. I see. How'd you do that?
It's a good question. I noticed it about a year ago, and I went to the clinic about it, and they told me that it was normal for one to be larger than the other.
Oh, there you go.
All right. That's no fun. I'm not so interested in that call. Just let me talk to one person. We'll go to break. I'll sell it. I'll do that back sell thing. You know that radio thing you do, Drew? That good radio thing that we never do? Cody?
Yes, sir.
Uh-oh. Are you drunk?
No, sir.
Head injury.
Great. All right. I'll see you in hell. Fantastic. All right. Yeah. What happened?
I was 19. I was riding a three-wheel all-terrain vehicle.
Oh, Jesus
and
Christ.
And I wasn't wearing a helmet, and somehow I flipped off and hit my head on a rock, and I spent 9 months in the hospital in Oklahoma for a head injury.
No, that ruined the camping trip for everyone else.
Yeah, so.
Oh, that's horrible. Those things, those ATV vehicles, they're crazy. People just roll those all over the place. Hey, yeah. Cody?
Yes, sir.
Are you doing all right now?
Yes, sir.
Hey, if it's any consolation, you're still smarter than 3/4 of the people that call this show,
yes,
even with that head trauma. You're more lucid than the average person who calls this show, even with your horrible injuries. So hold on a second, Cody.
Yes, sir.
Because I'm going to cure you when we come back, all right?
Okay,
can I promise that? All right, we have Valerie Richard from Dark Angel. Hey, Drew, come on, get... Come on, let me finish up. We'll be back.
Hello? Is this LoveLine?
Call 1-800-LOVE-191. Adam and Dr. Drew will be right back.
Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Valerie Rae Miller and Richard Gunn are both here from Dark Angel. Tuesday nights, Fox. The number one hit show of the new season. Drew, who's the page from? I know. Then don't make more of it than it was.
I had an itchy, itchy rash.
Yes? Emergency?
Don't even know yet.
Don't know? What do you do?
Not answering their phone, answering machines.
Okay, but that important.
Don't even start me.
My favorite
thing is when I call and the line's busy. That's my favorite.
Because they're trying to page you again.
No, they're talking to mom.
Now, let me tell you something about Drew.
Okay.
He is a soft touch. He is...
So you're a nice guy, Drew.
Yes.
Nothing wrong with that.
He's a nice guy, and he's a passionate, passionate man as well. Don't let the nice guy fool you. He likes the ladies.
But
oh,
you
yeah.
need somebody to sniff. You need somebody to put some smack down, you know me now. I got you.
He cannot...
Exactly. Thank way. You.
He cannot put or do the smack down. I don't know which context is correct. I smacked down twice yesterday, by the way, before I came to the studio.
Good but for you.
I'm saving my smackdown session for later tonight.
Did smack and done smacked.
I did and done smacked. Drew does not put the smack down. Instead, he sees and gets angry inside, and then he explodes when he's with his kids. All right, Cody.
Yes, sir.
You're 27. You had that head injury in 92 when you were 19 years old.
Yes, sir.
Riding one of those three-wheel ATVs.
I wasn't wearing a helmet neither.
No helmet. You know the problem with those ATVs that makes them so dangerous is I've been camping, I've been desert riding a million times with all these construction guys the whole life. And yes, the thing about when a guy gets on a dirt bike in the desert, he looks at the dirt bike as, okay, I'm going to put my helmet on, I'm going to put my gear on, I'm going to dirt bike riding.
Right.
They look at the ATV as sort of a shuttle. It's like, I'm not going to do any riding. I'm just going to go over to the snack stand and grab something, or I'm going to head over down here. They're like a golf cart,
right,
almost.
Right.
Like a mini
and
car.
And they get on it, and they're barefoot. They're wearing a pair of Zoris and
going
some shorts. And they're going down the road because they're going to the John or the snack stand or something. But before you know it, they're hot-dogging it a little bit and whacking their head on a rock.
It just kind of creeps
up
on.
Yeah, it kind of draws you in, whereas like the dirt bike, you don't get on it in your shorts.
Because it looks more dangerous. It's more inherently dangerous.
This thing, you see kids putting around on these things that are 4 and a half riding these things in a pair of shorts around the campsite. Cody, what happened with you?
I was in, I don't know what happened. I just flipped off of it, I guess. The police report says I hit a rock and lost control. But that's all the memory I have of it.
And then you were in the hospital for 9 months, did you say?
Yes, sir.
And what did they have to do to you?
I had 3 craniotomies and a tracheotomy.
Wow.
The craniotomy is where they remove a bird from your head, Drew? Or how's that? What is that? It's a cranium. Pull the cranium off?
This is the cranium.
Take that off?
Okay. Extract it.
Bad times.
Yeah, I have 2 burr holes, too.
Burr holes.
To relieve the pressure?
Yeah.
Pull the blood out.
Yeah, because your head starts swelling. They got to drill holes in it. I could go with one of those.
Those permanent holes? Sometimes.
Hey, Cody.
Yes, sir.
You know, as they were fixing to do the third craniotomy, I would have piped up at that point. I don't care what kind of condition I was in. Listen, this is the last time you're pulling the crane off. You understand?
The cranium. Just put like a stopper in.
All right, unless you're going to put some Velcro on it, this is it. So whatever you got to do, do it. Should have done it the first time.
Well, they told my mom this was the last operation, and from then there, I would live or die.
Wow. So you're very lucky to be here.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Mm. Now what do? You?
I don't work. I just sat at home, basically.
Are you able to function? How's your body working?
My body, physically, I'm fine.
Mm. You are?
I have a little subluxation in my right arm where it was drawled up to my chin through my stay at the hospital.
Mm-hmm. Interesting.
And that's basically it. I got a cut on my shoulder.
But Cody.
Yes, sir.
See, it's kind of interesting, your condition, not in a good way, but as someone who's born with retardation, for instance, doesn't know any different world. You know what I mean? It's a difference between being blind at birth and going blind at 19.
Yeah.
You know what it's like to have full function and capacity.
Yes, sir.
And you're also in good enough shape, thank God, that you're aware that you're in bad shape.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Is that frustrating to you?
Oh, very frustrating. Suicide is a constant thought.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But, you know, you really, and I know it sounds like I was kidding, but if your body is functional And it sounds, you know, you don't sound, we've heard worse.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Drew's wife is worse. We really have heard worse on this show.
Have you been listening tonight? There have been a couple worse already.
Yeah, and it seems like with, you know, rehabilitation and what have you, you know, your body's working. I mean, it seems like you can have a decent life. What are the side effects beside the mental capacity being diminished?
No, I don't have any physical limitations.
Good. How's the penis?
Oh, it's fine. It works, I guess.
Okay.
Not very well, but it works.
Yeah, no.
Are you on any medications?
I'm on Tegretol.
Yeah, that shouldn't do much of that.
Is that for seizures?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So I'm turning into a goddamn doctor.
Luckily, I haven't had seizures yet.
All right.
All right, so why don't you think the penis is cooperating?
I don't know. I feel... I just want more than just the sex. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Well, there has to be some kind of love.
You want a blowjob?
Oh,
I see.
Like
right. No, of course.
He ain't looking for a relationship. I'm
talking about a handy or something like that.
Ménage à trois.
Yeah. So, well, listen. I. You know, Cody. Here's the good news. I know you think your disability is probably getting in the way of this, but women are remarkably mature.
Mm-hmm.
I knew a guy who was in a wheelchair, had the best looking. His girlfriend was Erica Laniak. It was the most beautiful blonde woman. She was on Baywatch, for Christ's sake. She's a playmate. I knew this guy. This is before, you know, he was in a wheelchair.
I had crushes on two different guys that were totally hot in wheelchairs.
Really?
Yeah. One of them actually was supposed to go out with one of them, and he just kind of chickened out, and he kind of stood me up. But
really?
I mean, I really liked him.
Really?
Yeah, really.
Yeah, those guys, so cool. They drive vans, all of them, so you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know what you're in
and they're
for.
Good. Like, if you hang out with them, if you ever have to go to IKEA, you always got to ride.
Park right out front.
In there, right?
You got a nice van, you get to park right out front. Hey, Cody.
Yes, sir.
All right. So you're looking for a more substantial relationship?
Oh, yeah. Yes, sir, I am.
But don't you think that part of that is just because of what your life has become, not because... Not that you have your diminished capacity mentally, but that you're unable to work. And I know it goes hand in hand, but you're living at home.
How do you
know
meet
what I
people?
Mean?
How do you meet people? Do you take classes, or are you in any organization so you can meet other people?
I was in a couple of, at Front Range College. I was in a couple of classes there, but I dropped them real quick because I had trouble getting to the bus. Then taking the bus to Boulder, then finding
that was a junior college?
Yeah.
Yeah, he didn't find the curriculum challenging enough, I think is what he's saying about junior college.
You got to get into some things where you can meet people.
Yeah, Cody, there's no easy answer other than you're alive, your body works. I mean, think about all those poor sons of bitches who did exactly what you did who are paralyzed. Now. Well, don't get me wrong, you're not super lucky.
But you're
I'm lucky to be alive, I understand.
Right, and you're lucky to have use of your limbs.
Yeah.
Most people who went through what you went through are bad from the neck down, you know?
Yes, sir.
All right, so use the internet and, you know, you can try to find something you can do and you know, I don't know. I mean, in a way, Drew, stop me if I'm wrong here, but... We talk to people that are in Cody's shape without Cody's condition all the time.
Exactly.
They're depressed. They're living at home. They're in between jobs. They can't get anything going. I think women respond more to that than the injury.
Exactly. I totally agree with that.
If this guy had the injury but yet was working, taking care of his stuff.
And you had interest in something and you were really trying to do something, and then maybe we could connect on some sort of, like, you know, level deeper than just, oh, hi, you're a guy.
Mm-hmm. For a guy, if this was a woman, if she was hot, it'd be even better. Better than a regular chick.
Sure.
It's like, hey, she can barely talk. Dude.
I'm here to tell you, for
you
some women,
stuck.
We're okay with that, too.
Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't be a bad, wouldn't you, you know, really super, like, hot chick who has
guys,
a little problem
the more damage the goods, you know, the slower, easier the target.
Right.
More guys are on top.
Right.
Uh-huh.
We love to find an old junker that we can fix up. Oh, yeah.
Well, it's not, I don't know if there's a junker. It's that if they're lagging behind the pack somehow. It's like a lion going after a troop of gazelles.
Easy prey, yeah. Because what they look at it is it's like this. It's like you ever go to the stereo store, the appliance store, whatever, and you find something with a dent in it, but it's twice as cheap? And you go, great, great. That dent's up against the counter side. I won't even see that. I'm getting that microwave, that fridge, that stereo, whatever it is. That's a score.
It's on sale.
Yeah, if a guy to be able to find a girl like this who was good looking and had a little trouble, that's a score. Because he's doing better than he could do.
Yeah, but then you got the babysitter.
Fine. I just put a bowl of water out. Chain her to the radiator. I'm going to Vegas for a week. You got enough kibble, honey? Hey, don't crap up the living room this time. Do it on the wood. Oh, for Christ's sake, it sinks right into the padding under the carpet there. Mike?
Nice.
Hello?
Yeah, I should start a home for the mentally challenged. All right, listen, I'm going to deadbolt the place. You guys got kibble and water. I turned the fan on because it's kind of hot outside.
Stay with
going
the Lucky
Charms. Going to Vegas to watch the fight.
The Lucky Charms theme. Go on.
That's why you know so much about Viagra, all these damaged goods. Sometimes you don't think it's so easy to get it up.
How dare you? She feels threatened by my masculinity, so she's lashing out. Mike?
Hey, how you guys doing?
Hey, you're 25. What's up?
What's up? Who's the guest?
We have Valerie and Richard both here from Dark Angel.
Hi, Mike.
Hi, Mike.
Oh, hey, how you guys doing?
Good, man. How are you?
You ever watch that Dark Angel?
Well, I've seen the commercials, but honestly, I haven't seen the show.
Everyone has seen
watch.
The commercial.
You gotta
watch
the show. Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. You just
all
missed
right,
it.
All right, I'll tune in.
Cool, man.
And there's a guy in a wheelchair in it, too.
Oh, there is?
Yeah.
Yeah, he's hot.
All right, that's the guy you want to date.
Yeah.
What's up there, Mike?
Hey, well, before I get to my question, I wanted to tell Drew that when I voted a couple weeks ago, I put his name down on the write-in ballot.
Wow.
So I know you didn't really qualify, but...
You're the one that messed up the election.
So you deserve it. You could do better than them, I'm sure.
Probably right.
Yeah.
Yeah. But anyways, my question was about when I masturbate, it seems that I get constipated. Hmm. Like if I feel like I have to use a bathroom... And I masturbate before that. It constipates me sometimes for like a day.
Well, you know what?
You get sucked back in or something.
Well, no, it's not sucked back in so much as what can happen is
I pulled part of the I pulled part of the comforter out of me once.
But it came right out again.
No, the only way I could get it out was to slam it in the door and then get a running start with the slam.
I said it, but it came out.
Yeah. Oh, it came out,
but it was unusable.
3 foot about.
You had to burn it.
It took with it, yeah.
Well, here's
what can happen, though, is that you can inflame your prostate. Your prostate can enlarge, and that can make it difficult for a stool to pass.
Mm-hmm.
And so if he's spending a lot of time masturbating and doing funny, stimulating things without releasing, that irritates the prostate.
He had the kind of voice that would say that he was doing a lot of funny things.
Yeah.
And had a long pre-check ritual.
Intense funny things.
Yes, yes. That ritual is, the prostate likes regular, frequent rapid release.
That's why I have the prostate of an 11-year-old.
That's right.
I said it many times. Yeah, it does happen every once in a while. I won't get into it with Drew because he won't admit to it. But Richard, I know you masturbate like a madman up there in Canada when you're filming the show. And once every 15th or 16th session, so every other day, when I'm sitting down to take care of myself, you get down there, you know what I'm saying, Richard, and you're like, oh, Christ, I got to take a leak. And then you go, oh, man, I already got the boner.
Yeah, I'll just work it out first.
I could go take the leak. I got to wait for the boner to go away. But I could whack off. It's not going to be that good if I got to take a leak, though.
But you got the Viagra, so the boner will stay.
Yeah, I know. I'm hopped up on that Viagra. Yeah. Use it as a suppository, the urethra suppository and a rectal suppository, as well as taking it orally and nasally. And lobally through the ear.
Every orifice.
I've learned far more about Adam than I ever cared to
know. What I do with Viagra is I grind it up, I put it into a humidifier, and I let it run in the room so that I actually absorb the Viagra through the pores, through the eyes. Right, Drew?
Nice. So he's permanently stiff like he's been starched.
That's right.
That's right.
Ancient Chinese secret. All right, Valerie and Richard both here from Dark Angel, Tuesday nights, Fox.
Just to think you used to waste all that money on rhino horn.
Yeah, I've moved on. Spanish fly, rhino horn, and now on to the Viagra. We'll be back after this.
Hello, this is your radio.
LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew. Valerie Rae Miller and Richard Gunn are both here from Dark Angel on Fox, 9 o'clock, Tuesday nights. The really biggest hit of the new year. I can't name a show that's got more good press publicity. And boy, they're really behind this show. I mean, James Cameron and Ed, they put more. I heard the pilot was like $7-8 million or yeah. something like that.
It was 10. She's just like the Man Show.
How dare you make fun of the Man Show? That's right. But you know, we put a lot of love in our show. Yeah, we don't have the big budget. But I mean, it's really it's like making a movie once
right.
a week.
Exactly. It's a yep. lot of work.
I mean, not that many years ago. I know everyone's used to the $100 million budget now, but it just go back 10 or 15 years. I mean, go back to the mid-80s, and you talk about the $10 million for the budget of a film. That's pretty healthy budget. And you're shooting it. I mean, it's like, right?
It's like
making a film, a weekly film.
Yep.
Seems horribly ambitious to me. I want no part of it.
It takes them about 9 days to do one.
At least.
Yeah.
Technically,
really?
Yeah. It's a lot of work, and it's a lot of hours, even with 9 days. It's far more than what the average one-hour show takes to do.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I mean, Drew, how many of those one-hour Loveline episodes would we do in a day?
Four. Six.
Wow.
Four.
With all the special
four
effects.
Minimum.
Four in one day. Four in one day in about 6.5 hours.
And we'd
hours.
Start at 1 in the afternoon, and there'd be huge breaks.
Yeah, big long lunches. Yeah, I mean, in 4 1-hour episodes. Jesus Christ. Who knows what the budget was. Hey, Drew?
Yeah.
You want to reconsider your options over there?
How about that?
Robert?
Yes?
Hey, you're 13.
Yeah.
What's up, Sparky?
Oh, not much. I just wanted to congratulate the Dark Angel. Yeah, watch that tonight. That was kick.
Thank you.
Thanks, Robert.
You got a great voice, Robert.
Thanks.
Yeah,
you're
when those nuts drop, you're really going to like it.
And my other question is that my brother, I don't do drugs, but my brother does.
Mm.
And so he wanted me to pee in a bag for him so he could take it.
No, don't do it. Don't do it.
And I was just wondering, because it's really making me feel...
Wait a minute. What kind of bag? Duffel bag? Gym bag?
He wants to use his urine.
Wants to use
for
his urine
sample.
For evil?
Yeah. For evil.
I used urine for evil when I was young.
I know you
did. I regret every day of it now. I really do.
Don't do it.
We used it as a weapon.
Yeah. I had to defend myself against other urine.
His brother doesn't want to pour it on people.
Oh, he doesn't want to pour it on people?
No. But you're allowing him, you're enabling him to continue his drug addiction.
Exactly.
It's a bad thing. It's going to hurt him.
But what?
He got me started smoking and stuff like that a long time ago.
Smoking what?
No, just cigarettes.
Is he threatening to physically harm you if you don't provide him with urine?
No, not at all. But
How old is he, did you say?
He's 20.
Sounds like a dynamite individual.
He should know better.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, I'm going to get my brother started. I'll get him smoking at 11, and he'll graduate.
Nine.
They'll graduate. Oh, I'll get him smoking cigarettes at 9. He'll graduate into whizzing into a water balloon.
Yeah.
Yeah, by the time he's 13.
Well, he won't be making
Fantastic.
You do any drugs or trying to get you to do any drugs if he wants to use your urine.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, next thing, he's what, 20?
Yes.
So I'd say when he's like 23, 24, he's going to come back. Hey, making some gay porn. drop your pants. See what you got down there.
Oh,
fantastic.
God.
Yeah, I got a job for you.
Yeah, he's not. He needs to get caught. It's going to help him hopefully get access to treatment.
What is he trying to do? He's trying to get a job?
Yeah, because he is going to college right now, and
hold on. This is junior college.
Mm-hmm. No.
4-year college?
Yeah.
Where?
At, I don't know, some tech school.
Tech school?
Train tech. There's lots of drugs in 4-year college.
Yeah. Listen, right?
It's welding school.
Yeah. He's repairing welding.
Yeah.
Well, he might be
equipment.
Using,
using
instruments that could harm him or others.
Yeah. Mm. No, he's...
Mm-mm. He don't need to be doing drugs.
He's been doing drugs since he was young because... He didn't get along with his dad or my mom.
All right, but Robert, the sheer fact the guy got you started smoking at 9.
Yeah.
How do you smoke at 9? How does that work?
It doesn't.
What do you do now?
I have a patient.
I quit it all.
Good for you.
I have a Mexican patient start smoking when she was 8.
Oh, sure.
She's now 93.
That's the average age when she's going to begin smoking.
Been smoking two packs a day, and her parents gave her cigarettes to smoke because they had no food, and it suppressed their appetite, so the kids weren't so uncomfortable.
I'm going to do that with my kids.
She's 93, and she's been smoking her whole life?
Two packs a day since she was 8.
Yeah.
Oh, didn't make it.
It's bizarre.
She's fine, but she killed a family of 8 with her secondhand smoke.
Exactly.
All right, hey, Robert.
Yeah.
Don't pee in anything.
Okay.
I'll tell you, thank
you. You're the better man.
One of my greater urination stories from high school, speaking of peeing and stuff, my buddy, she's
Ray.
Okay, it was Ray. Yeah. Yeah, I didn't want to mention his name. He's tired of hearing it from other people, but he took a leak, and I've told you this one, I think, Drew, but
I didn't hear
kids
it.
Like, he took a leak in like a cup, like a paper cup, and he thought he was going to throw it on my head, you know?
Like you normally did. Like you usually did with pee.
Yeah, because it was Tuesday at noon, and it was time for me to get
a
pee on the head.
Get a urine on the head.
Yeah.
And we're running around my house, and he had somehow set this cup of urine down on, like, the kitchen counter, and the fight then broke out outside the house and ran in and ran out. Anyway, now I was in the house, and he was locked out of the house, basically, and he was creeping around the house trying to find a way in to use his urine cup. And we had this, the window was broken, and our bad sign, by the way, when, here's how you know you're white trash. When you break a window and you start putting stuff up in place of glass, like, you know what it is? You blow it. You throw a softball through a window, so you take the cutting board, which fits quite nicely in the same place. Anything but go down to the goddamn hardware store and drop $4 on a piece of glass. That's all right. Well, but get some foil. Put a skateboard out there.
Very creative people like trash.
So why can't you just go down and get a new piece of glass? But when you're white trash, you don't do that. So
no, you have to make use of the junk pile in your backyard.
You got to start thinning the junk out. Getting rats back there. So we had a metal grate. It was like a kind of piece of like steel with holes in it, and you couldn't see through it. When you're inside the house and it was light outside, you could see through perfectly. But when you're outside, it looked black.
But you still get the draft.
Ray put his head right up against the thing, and he cupped his hands on each side of his eyes so he could cut the light to see. And I just stood there holding that cup of urine. And when his nose got pushed far enough against the grill where I could see part of it poking through my side, I whipped it at him in a baseball type maneuver. And blinded him. I mean, almost detached his retina.
That was great.
Drew, you know me. Now picture me at 17. How happy was I myself at that point?
Like the chimpanzees.
Like,
you said 17. I thought you were like 12.
Oh, no. Could have been 18. I was like, you know what Snoopy is when Charlie Brown comes home? That's how I was. All right, we're going to take ourselves a break talking about Dark Angel tonight, and we'll be back after this.
Love Line. 1-800-LOVE-191. Back in a minute.
Hey, Loveline, hottest 120 minutes on radio. Yeah. That's good radio there. Snuck that right in the beat. Talking to Richard Gunn and Valerie Rae Miller, both from Dark Angel, Tuesday nights, 9 o'clock on Fox. Drew is God knows where, maybe another page or something.
He's got business.
Yeah. He really takes his show seriously. I haven't brought this up.
Itchy rash.
I haven't brought this up in a while, but isn't it a travesty that we get paid the same amount? Oh, here he is. There you are, there, Drew.
Hi, Drew.
How are you? Hey, bud. Ready to rock here?
Let's go.
Everclear tomorrow night. Always good to see the guys from Everclear. So they'll be here tomorrow night. And Jeff?
Yeah.
You're 19. What's up?
Yeah. I just quit doing drugs and drinking and everything like a week ago.
Good for you.
Very good.
And ever since then, I've been having kind of like blackouts just for like a second. And I was wondering if that's normal or... If that happens to...
You can't stop. If you've been... alcohol, what other drug were you using?
What? Excuse me?
Alcohol and what other drug were you using?
Oh, I was just... I would take weed and prescription pills.
Are you still tremulous?
You're still shaking a lot?
Yeah, I get nervous. And
what prescription pill were you taking?
Vicodin, Xanax, anything.
You could really have seizures at this stage. This is not something you do without being supervised.
Yeah.
Okay. It people die of alcohol withdrawal. People don't realize that. In fact,
really? I'm in like AA programs and stuff.
That's great. But you know, call people in the program, call a sponsor, and tell them you talk to a doctor. You need to be seen because to be covered for seizure.
Yeah, but what about 1 week after you quit? Are you out of, what's the most dangerous time? Is it the next day?
It's about, there's a peak at about 4 or 5 days, but he's benzodiazepine and alcohol.
Yeah.
And there is a second peak 10 to 14 days out.
Oh, really?
And actually the risk of a seizure from the Xanax and stuff he's doing is actually increasing right now.
So it doesn't just go off incrementally?
Two peaks.
Oh. Interesting. And
especially with the Xanax.
How long does it take to filter out of your body, out of your system?
2 hours. It's just your brain has been altered, and it takes a year for the brain to go back to normal.
Oh,
and the withdrawal part of the stabilization takes a couple of weeks.
Hey, and, Jeff?
It's why this has to be medically supervised. And, you know, some people document fatality rates with DTs, true DTs, at 60%.
So I should go talk to my doctor?
Yeah. Yes, absolutely. Yeah,
just my family doctor?
Either that or go by an emergency room, or even right now, and talk about what's happening here. They should be able to give you something to cover you.
Well, is a blackout some sort of precursor to the seizure?
Probably is small seizures.
Is that what that is?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's kind of scary.
Yeah. Well, you're pretty much into the substance, right?
Yeah.
Right. How'd you quit without a program or thing?
Well, he's going to community program.
Well, I know, but he was on a lot of stuff. He didn't have to detox or anything. Well, I mean, go in house.
I got put in jail for.
Oh, okay. Well, there you go. That now see
he went in house.
So you quit cold
in-house.
Turkey.
Yeah. Yeah, that was him going into the jail, except for it was more
no
of a,
clink.
It was a trunk, I think is what it was.
And I believed it.
Yeah, it's funny. I was thinking, well, geez, how'd this guy? It didn't sound like the kind of guy who would just quit on his own at 19, but he went into the can.
It's good for you. You can do it.
Oh, yeah. And look at it this way. Short 51 weeks from now, your brain will be right back to normal.
Well, you stay with the program, you get better.
Yeah. Exactly.
There you go. Mike?
Hi.
Hey, you're 18. What's up?
For starters, Drew, you said on the show that the brain develops through the ages of 11 and 17.
Wait, what are you talking about?
I've heard you say, it was not long ago, a couple of days ago, that the brain develops through the ages of 11 and 17. Is that true?
No.
What
brain develops right until 21.
What about,
what's that?
Why 11 and 17?
Yeah, well, I understand.
Through the ages of 11 and 17.
Between them. What's happening before 11?
I have no idea.
Your brain's developing, okay.
Okay.
Of course.
It goes right on until you're 21.
When do you think all those Japanese kids learn to play the violin? That's not after 11, smartass.
Okay.
But what's your question?
Basically, my question is... Well, I was going to ask if smoking pot, like chronically smoking pot through those ages could affect sexual development.
You mean sexual identity?
I guess that's what you call it, yes. Preference.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Remember I was saying earlier, I think it was Cody called in, had himself a little head trauma.
Uh-huh.
Told him, don't worry, there's people with no trauma that are in worse shape than you are.
Uh-huh.
I think we might have found our match with Mike over here.
Well, that was another question. If pot smoking can cause permanent damage or, because I was under the impression that smoking pot, chronically smoking pot can't cause... any kind of permanent damage.
It's actually debatable.
But it's like this. I don't want to sound like I'm too high on my horse here because Lord knows I smoke a little weed once in a while. But if you took a kid who was 11, locked him in the closet and played him the same Smashing Pumpkins CD until he was 18, and then let him out of the closet, it seemed like he had brain damage. Well, even if his brain wasn't physically damaged, he was deprived.
That is exactly right.
It
blocks the usual developmental process to some extent. It also has been shown on radiographic procedures to actually cause certain areas of shrinkage of the brain. There is growing evidence some of that may be permanent. I'm not convinced. It looks to me like most of that's reversible. But in the meantime, you've missed all the developmental milestones of adolescence and are left with difficulty managing feelings.
And right. You don't want to do anything but sit around your house. You're missing life, buddy.
Because I have smoked a lot of pot. And, like, when it comes down to, like, standardized tests, I do just as good as my sister who hasn't smoked any.
Right.
Yeah, it doesn't have emotional development.
Yeah, it tends not to affect intellect so much. Well, if it can affect memory, it can. But
she's into crack, by the way. Yeah.
But it's more. We're really talking about your emotional development, your personality development.
You're missing life by doing that all the time.
Oh, hold on. Let me defend that. Mike, I've been outside. It's no big deal. Nothing. They always talk about how great it is. Listen, you're parking.
It's overrated.
You get a parking ticket and a bad hot dog, you go home crying. That's it. It's one big line out there, brother. You stay home.
Okay.
You got cable?
Actually, I don't have a TV now.
Uh-oh, now you got problems.
Well, you wouldn't be able to pay the bills anyway.
What are you supposed to do without TV when you're smoking a lot of pot?
Yeah.
Well, I know it's kind of weird, actually. I've been reading lately about
All right. You're fine. Now, what was your question? Was that your question?
Well, basically, I don't know whether, don't know what sex I prefer. And I know that sounds really strange, but...
No, it doesn't.
I don't know how to go about,
trial and error.
And I've kind of done that, but... And I'm kind of a nice guy, so I don't like to do that because I feel like I'm using people and...
Yeah, well, you don't have to worry about the guys.
They're getting something out of it.
Yeah.
Well, now, look, is it that you have difficulty connecting with people and don't really feel like intimacy is important to you?
I think that has some...
Because I get that definite feel from you. I've known several patients who they just can't connect. And so it could be... This is like one step below zoophilia. You know, humans are like not that important to them. This is their perception of it.
Mm-hmm. These one step, male, female, one step below banging a sheep.
Talking about a
one step
sociopath.
Away from. Oh, one step away.
A scavenger.
Not necessarily sociopath, but you can see how that tendency could be there.
All right, but wait a minute.
So weird. You guys are always so right because I don't miss people. I don't. You know, people always say, "Did you miss me?" And I.
Yeah. Were you like left severely abandoned when you were like young child?
My parents divorced, but that's about it.
How old were you?
That can have a serious effects.
Yeah, how old were you?
I don't know, 3.
Okay. Are you living at home now?
No, I'm on my own.
I see. And things are going great? You have no TV?
Smoke pot and just have sex with everybody.
He reads.
All right.
It's not that bad.
Mike, yeah. All right. So you don't, you're off the weed, right?
Well, no, uh-oh. Not really, no. Right. I mean, I've been smoking up till yesterday. I haven't smoked any today. But.
Oh, okay.
that'll distance you from humanity.
Clean, that's true.
Yeah, you're cured. You're cured.
Here's the deal, Mike. There's now tremendous fields of study about how people regulate their emotional world. And one thing that's very clear is the ability to connect with other people is actually what activates emotional growth. The presence of another person available for you is what allows us to tolerate feelings that we otherwise couldn't tolerate, allows us to develop emotionally. Without that connection, we develop lots of defensive strategies. But unless you can find a way to connect, it's going to be a very empty existence for you. You've got to give people an opportunity to kind of let them in emotionally, or else the only thing you're going to have to regulate your emotional world is pot, or later something heavier, I predict.
All right. Let's talk to Michael, who's 16. Michael?
Yes?
What's up?
I've been masturbating since I was 12. Mm-hmm. And...
You're healthy.
16.
Yeah.
And it was really serious. I mean, serious masturbating, like, 5 times a day.
Mm-hmm.
And I first found out what an orgasm was because I was...
Because it landed on your belly?
No,
jacking off feverishly since 12, and you first learned of the orgasm at what?
No, it happened before. The reason why I started masturbating was because I put my, I had my cat, and I tried rubbing against it real hard and stuff, and I had an orgasm, and that's what started me.
Did you say your cat?
Was this when you were 12?
Yeah. Yeah, I used to bang the bejesus out of Norman. That was a calico we had growing up.
Well, about 2 years ago, I wasn't getting, like, anything out of it or anything. I wasn't ejaculating, getting orgasm. So I, like, went into masochism.
Right.
And, like...
What did you do?
Like, I'll tie strings and stuff around my penis.
Mm-hmm. You do the puppet move? Done that.
Yeah.
The girls like that.
So, yeah, so it gets bigger.
You need a little top hat and a cane.
I got no strings.
That's right. Great.
And, like...
Did you hurt yourself?
Yeah.
Hey,
what'd you do?
Huh?
What happened?
Well, like, after a while, it can tear the skin.
Yeah. Can you imagine that?
Are you on medication, Michael?
No.
Are you supposed to be?
I was.
No. Why aren't you getting back into the proper care?
I'm going to bring up young Cody who had the head trauma again. Remember that?
Yeah.
Very prophetic.
I was on Ritalin, but I was allergic to it.
Yeah, well, you need to get... That was not a psychiatrist that prescribed that, was it?
Huh?
Was that a psychiatrist that prescribed that or a pediatrician?
Psychiatrist.
Okay, you need to get back into their care again. You need to talk about this stuff.
Mike, I'm more interested in you having your way with the cat.
Well, this is another thing, too.
Yeah, well, hold on.
But the cat ceased to do it for him.
Yeah, hold on a second, though. You're hard-pressed to get your cat, you know, on your lap, much less hump it. You know what I mean? Cats aren't very agreeable creatures. You might as well try raping a raccoon while you're at it. How the hell did your cat hold still long enough?
She's declawed.
He mastered it. He mastered the cat.
He's declawed.
Oh, whoa. It.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, what'd you do? I mean, you had to wrestle the cat, right?
I just had to hold it.
Your cat is maybe traumatized,
dude. Maybe the cat liked it.
Does the cat still come around you? Oops.
Hardly.
All right. Michael's giving me the creeps. What do you think?
Yeah, Mike needs some help.
Yeah.
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 Yeah, you need to stop hurting your body with strings. Do you want to see if he had the requisite history here for sexual compulsion?
I don't know. He sounds... Michael.
Yeah?
Were you ever raped or abused?
When I was little, like kindergarten.
Yeah. What happened?
Well, I lived in an Air Force base, and all these, like, 12-year-olds and everything, they're, like, huge kids to me. They had some secret club, and I always wanted to be in that club. And, like, they make me, like, strip in front of them.
Yeah.
And, like, one guy, he's trying to get me to insert my penis into his ass. And
Right. Mm. All right. So this is where it came from.
Right. Yeah,
I mean, just growing up on an Air Force base is bad cause enough for therapy, it really is. Hey, Michael.
Yeah.
Listen, you got to get back with the program.
You got to get treatment.
Psychiatrist, you got to get on the right medication.
The thing is, like, girls won't even, I don't know.
Good.
Those problems will be solved, though, after
listen,
the treatment.
Listen, can you blame them? You're humping cats and tying fishing string around your door.
I mean, even girls won't work out with me. I mean, like.
I know. Good.
They don't do anything.
Listen, that's God's plan.
Exactly.
You don't want you having any kids.
You don't need to be doing anyway. You need to worry about treatment.
If you get your mind healthy, then everything will follow after that.
People will be attracted to you when you start feeling better about yourself.
Yep. Yes, they will. Yeah, but he's got to get on his medication. He's got to go back to a psychiatrist.
Mm-hmm. You get no play.
That's right. Michelle?
Yeah?
Yeah, I mean, imagine, you guys look back, Richard and Drew, you look back at yourself in high school and go, geez, what a piece of work.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Yeah. I mean, you roll your eyes.
I think
to yourself, you realize, oh, my God, no wonder I wasn't getting any tail in high school.
But comparatively, I was okay.
But you weren't raping any pets.
No, I wasn't raping pets. I wasn't tying fishing line around.
So Michael's going to look back to his high school days and go, yeah, no wonder. Michelle?
Yeah?
You're 17. Michelle. What's up?
Hi. I have a question for Dr. Drew.
Mm-hmm.
I've heard that you can take multiple doses of... birth control pills?
Certain ones.
Instead of the morning after pill?
Certain ones.
Which ones?
Well, basically the ones that have levonorgestrel.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's the Preven pill is ethinyl estradiol and levonorgestrel.
Sure.
And I think Plan B is just levonorgestrel. So that's what you want to look for. And so low overall, a less, even the triphasic pill, some of them you can take.
Why, which one do you have?
I take multiple doses.
Because for morning after pill.
I'm on Ortho Novum 777, so that won't work.
I'd have to, I don't have a PDR here, but I have to look at what's in it. But I don't think that would work.
Okay.
You really? Why don't you just get the morning after pill? But wait, you're on the pill. Why are you worrying about it?
Well, I just want to make sure. You know, I'm just.
Wait a minute. Michelle, if there were a more certain way to take the pill, we would recommend you to do that. Okay. You're only going to screw things up if you alter the way you take the birth control pill.
Okay.
You take it at the same time every day.
Right.
And if you use any other medications concurrently, make sure you use a condom also.
Okay.
All right. That's it.
If you're taking the pill right, you're not pregnant.
Are you worried that you're pregnant now?
No, I'm not worried now. I just like to be very safe.
All right. Good girl. Safe sex, down the pill.
Yeah, have a condom and be on the pill.
You're not getting pregnant.
Where could I get the morning after pill from?
Any pharmacy.
You don't need to stockpile that stuff.
Well, it's not a bad idea.
You think?
If women have that.
Just in case.
I'm curious if I ever needed to.
Yeah, it's not a bad idea to have that. That's a reasonable thing to have around.
All right, Michelle.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. See, our callers, they break off into these two categories, which is ones like Michelle over here, who are extra safe and extra paranoid.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're the ones who are like, yeah.
Are doing their cat. Exactly.
They're doing the cat. But the women are like, he came, in and on me, but he was drunk, and I don't think this sperm is worked when you're drunk.
Yeah, we use condoms sometimes.
Yeah.
I think Michelle should have condoms and be on the pill if you're that worried about it. Absolutely. I think that's the best thing to do.
Yep, it is.
Yeah, but not for the boyfriend. Kagan?
Cares.
Keegan?
Yeah, it's Kagan. You got it right.
Kagan, great. You're 15. What's up?
Yeah, I just want to say hi to the cast.
Hey, man, how you doing?
How you doing?
I love your show. It's a great show.
Oh, thanks.
Thank you.
I've been watching it since the beginning. It's great.
Oh, that's awesome, man. Thank you.
Good looking out, man.
Yeah, so, What are your two characters? I'm sorry, I don't really know.
Sketchy.
And Original Cindy.
Okay, yeah. I love your characters.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. So.
We like you. Taking notes. Yeah. Okay,
you all right, Kane?
Yeah.
You got a deadline for the school newspaper or something? You got to put issue to bed?
She wants to say hi.
All right.
Well, hi. Thank you.
Where are you calling from, Kagan?
California. I'm in Pasadena.
Oh, hi. Cool. Kagan?
Drew's going to give you a tap on the horn as he drives by your place on the way home.
Very often tonight, sure enough.
Hey, Kagan.
Yeah.
Who's the, I'm trying to think of the guy I hate so much on PBS. Huell Hauser, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
You know who Huell Hauser is?
Oh. Yeah, I do.
Yeah, you do. How do you know who Huell Hauser is?
Well, my mom loves KCT.
I see.
Sometimes she's on.
Thank you. Okay. just checking from Pasadena.
15-year-old.
15.
And thank you for watching the show.
43 and from Pasadena.
I don't think he tried to get it on with his cat.
No. Oh, my God, that poor cat. That cat is probably sitting in a kitty therapist's office right now. Oh, you want to know why my fur's a mess?
I'll tell you.
You really want to know? You want to know why I'm dragging this throw pillow?
I can't wash it.
Oh, it's just cat.
No, speaking of therapists, I was reading.
Worst cat to rape. The worst animal to rape's a cat. It really is. Worst.
Yeah, squirrel. Yeah, squirrel. No,
believe you me.
Of the domesticated cats, I agree with you. But
yeah,
listen.
Raccoon and squirrel in the wild. In a pinch.
Most camping, popular one like is the hamster. Guinea pig.
Gold. Hamster, guinea pig, dog, sheep.
You always see dogs on the internet.
Chickens,
yeah.
Chickens, nice. Things like that.
Horse on the internet. I've
horse.
Seen that.
Horse, nice. Fine. A little intimidating.
What do you spend your time doing, Valerie?
reading.
On the internet. But I was... Diane Wallerstein's book about divorce. I just happened to be flipping through it tonight, and it was interesting. She was making a point that one of the things that kids get affected by most by divorce is that their mother becomes less available to them after a family dissolves. And so really many children of divorced family report the loss of their mother, feeling the complete loss of her availability and detachment from her as a result of the divorce.
Also when the stepfather comes into the picture.
In further taking her away. And so just listening to Adam every night whine about his mother made me think about it.
Was I whining about my mother? Is that what brought this up?
No, you're talking about therapy.
It's about raping chickens.
You're talking about therapy. And
that has nothing to do with his mother.
Reminded me, you're talking about your therapy and how little you talk about in your therapy.
Mom, I'm so mad at you! You, Mom.
That is excellent.
See what I'm saying?
That was last week's show. I'm over that now, though.
All right.
She wouldn't let him.
I thought that was an interesting point. I thought maybe you could sort of corroborate that. Would you? Is that?
accurate? Or?
Well, I mean, my mom was out of it before the divorce, though. Mm-hmm. I don't. Oh, you mean did the divorce pull mom farther away?
Yeah.
No. Not my. I mean, my mom was just smoked a lot of weed and stayed in her room, you know?
Yeah, but, I've seen the picture of your family. She seemed kind of together. Everything's kind of okay. And then, doing. she loses it.
How dare you attack my mother that way? You know, I built a shrine to her, Drew. I'll blacken your eye for that kind of talk. How dare you, sir?
I believe I was quoting you, by the way.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
No, I just got done whacking off to my mom. Totally out of context.
That is great.
If you could have heard the conversation before that, you'd realize it was totally out of context. You whacking off
something
to my
about the dad.
Listen, both parents, I think, try to keep it together a little bit better when they're in front of the other parent, and especially in front of the kid. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
I think there's an attempt. Like Drew, isn't in your marriage. I know your wife keeps a fairly tight leash around you,
mm-hmm.
But it's not really a leash, more of a handle. A leash would suggest there's some room for lateral movement.
Well, you got to train them. You have to train them.
She took a drawer handle and just put some wood screws into her spine. She hangs on him like a piece of Samsonite when he's around the house. But when your wife, when Susan's there and you're around the kids, mm-hmm. even though you love your kids, there's a certain kind of way you have to sort of act, and it's almost responsible or respectful of the spouse as they pertain to the kids. Mm. So it's like it's almost how you would act. The difference between how you act when you're alone and when you act when you're with somebody at work or whatever.
You know what I'm saying?
You've
got to put up the parent front.
You might not even realize it, but the fact that there's, you know, a couple of kids and mommy and daddy in the room sort of makes you a unit, makes you a family. And when you're not drunk and fighting, you do kind of act more that way. And if your wife was to take off, you might plant yourself on the sofa and tell the kids to, you know, go out in the yard and play, you know, mm-hmm. play on the compound.
That's what you mean, yeah.
Yeah, so just not having the pressure of the other person, another adult. Yeah,
that's not even called like the check. It's like a check and balance.
Yeah.
They affect each other.
Doesn't even need to be another parent. It could be an adult.
Yeah.
Just one of your, you know how people act with their kids when their friends are sitting around, their adult friends, they're all of a sudden their world's greatest parent, and then they come back and the kids, kid's wearing a bowl on his head and he's just been raped. You know how it is.
I don't know why he's doing that. He never does that at home.
That's right. What's with the excessive masturbation and the crying? He's three. Is that healthy? Yeah, he's fine. You reach up to scratch your head, the kid flinches and starts crying. All right, we'll take a little break. We'll be back after this.
Oh, yeah, everybody now.
You're listening to LoveLine on Outrageous Talk Radio, 100.7 The Buzz.
LoveLine, Adam Carolla is there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Everclear is going to be in here tomorrow night.
Is that their music right now?
I don't know. That's Incubus.
Like I like it.
All right.
Yeah, they're a good band.
Well, if you like Incubus, you'll love Everclear. Valerie Rae Miller and Richard Gunn are both here from Dark Angel, 9 o'clock, Tuesday nights on Fox. And let's hop back on the phones and speak to...
Shailene.
Shailene. Yes.
Hi, Shailene.
Hi.
Yeah.
I like your guys' show. I listen to it every night. You know, I just had to say it like everybody else.
Thanks, Shailene.
Well, my question is that I have a very hard time, like, when I'm, like...
Turn your radio down.
Okay, hold on.
Feedback.
Oh, boy.
Okay.
Never gets old.
Well, what happens is when I, like, when you're, like, saying you're making out with a guy or anything, I don't ever get aroused, and I can't. It's, like, impossible for me. I've done it a few times, but...
Done what?
Well, just like getting aroused. It's really difficult for me to.
She's made out.
Bad kissers.
Have you made out a few times?
Oh, yeah. Well, I've made out, you know, and, you know, done things, but it just, anything, like, it doesn't get me, like, I'll sit here and I'll be in the mood, and then once I get started, I will, like, just, like, drop out of it.
Hmm. Maybe you're thinking about it too much. Because sometimes I know, like, if you go into your head at the wrong time, like, you're feeling something, and then you start worrying about something else, or, you know, maybe this isn't right that I'm doing it, or something.
Worrying
like that
is the operant word here.
Maybe you're trying to be aroused so much that you're not.
Not really, because, you know, so, like, I like porn, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And that's really interesting to me, but it's just, like, when I get into a situation.
It is. That's so fascinating.
I find porn so fascinating, I don't even have sound up.
But maybe
I'm fascinated by it.
Maybe your experience isn't living up to your expectation. Maybe you have something going in your head with the porno.
Maybe the porno's tainted your
vagina.
Hey, I think it's just anxiety provoking to people. And you're 17, you're getting going.
It's like to the male gender, but when I get attracted to the same sex.
Uh-huh. That's okay.
Like possibilities.
Right.
Yeah.
But I haven't experienced anything, and it's like, and I'm thinking from like past experiences could have had effects on my
what? What happened? What happened to you?
Well, I got sexually molested by my mother and her boyfriend at the same time.
Oh my God.
Hold on.
That's major.
No. Perfectly normal, perfectly healthy.
Yeah, everyone experienced that at least by the age of 7, I'd say, wouldn't you think?
In America.
It was a while ago, and I've learned to deal with it.
No, Charlene, no.
That's not a normal thing deal with.
Yeah, that rewires your brain.
Yeah, there's something to that for sure.
All right, well, hold on. Before we convince her to kill herself tonight, I'm going to say some things that are going to make you want to kill yourself tomorrow, Charlene. I'm going to hold off on that. First off, your mother, for Christ's sake,
mm-hmm.
and they both participated at the same time?
Yeah.
Heroin
my
acts?
Mother's in jail now for that and drugs and all.
Yeah.
I mean, I went through a whole lot.
So they're not around you anymore?
No. I live with my dad and my stepmom, which are really wonderful parents. I love my dad.
Right. Your mother just said to be... Well, first off, something horrible was done to your mother.
Mm. Yeah, it was. I know about her past and everything else.
By your grandfather.
Yeah.
That great old guy was someone put a bullet in his head.
I don't talk to him or anything.
Yeah, that's where it all started.
Listen, Satan shouldn't talk to him. He should really be offended.
Satan should have a talking to him.
Yeah, I'm totally fine with guys like that. Just I would love it if someone just took a shovel to them while they were asleep. Just a rusty goddamn shovel while they were asleep in their bed.
Well, that's when the death penalty kicks in. That's like people in their fridge.
Too long, too much. This is worse. I got to tell you. Hold on. I seriously, killing somebody... on the just this sort of scope of human being, you know, 10 being best and 1 being, you know, I don't know, Hitler or Charles Manson or something, or Richard Simmons or someone of that ilk. One being. Okay, the point
is a guy
who murders somebody is like a 3, and a guy who bangs his daughter's a 2. To me, that's lower. It's worse. Mm-hmm. I understand murder in a way is a component of being a human. Right. We don't act
on
it.
Everybody Thank has God, that but compulsion, but you may not actually do it.
Yes, but if someone put a gun in your hand and someone and a beer in your belly and someone did the right thing to you at the right time, you could do something to them. But there's no amount of beer that could get you to do this to your daughter.
There's nothing to provoke if that you're, behavior.
Right. You went and looked for it.
It's not out of self-defense. It's not about anything.
It's about having been abused themselves.
Yes,
exactly,
obviously.
Exactly.
All right, so here's the deal. All bets are off for you, sweet pea.
Uh-huh.
You got to work on... First off, I want to commend you. You sound amazing for somebody who's been through what you've been through.
Mm-hmm.
I believe those experiences have made me a stronger person, and it helps me
too.
To deal with my friends if they're going through troubles.
You're still... You know, you're starting life off at a little bit of a disadvantage,
mm-hmm.
and it's going to take a lot to get back. And you're going to have to work hard. But that's going to make you a better, stronger person.
And you've already got that in you.
In the meanwhile, something like your sexuality, all bets are off for a few years.
Right.
I mean, you can have fun. You can experiment. Don't get pregnant, for Christ's sake.
Oh,
don't get the HIV or anything. Take care of yourself. But just you need to work on you as a person. And your compass should be spinning around like a dreidel sexually. You should have no idea because of the trauma that you've suffered.
Yeah, and exactly.
And to even have arousal is you can go into sort of 2 trajectories with this kind of history. One is you become hypersexual, and the other is you kind of shut down to sexuality.
me.
Well, yeah, because it doesn't, it just, nothing like that interests me.
Good. Those things will work out as soon if you fix, like, the deeper issue.
The opposite spectrum is that you're 17, you've made 28 porn movies already. That's right. Where you could have went. Yeah. So you didn't go there, so that's good.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so
I keep active and do sports and such.
Good.
Yeah.
All right. Right on. Take care of yourself.
Okay, thank you.
Tell your mom and stepdad I'll see him in hell. Make him a nice.
Okay, no problem.
Yeah. I want to be buried with a shovel, by the way, Drew.
To go after the smoke when you get to hell?
Well, to dig my way out in case something happens.
Oh, I see.
No, yes. For when I go to hell.
Go after these guys.
I'm bringing a shovel.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes. And I'll be very.
On.
You know me. I'm upset. You know what? You know, I fly first class, yeah. You know, as you know, I'm literally a millionaire, literally.
Yeah.
Now, and I fly the first class. You know how upset I get when they're out of, let's say, the salmon?
Yeah.
In first class?
Yeah.
Imagine how pissed I'm going to be when I'm in hell for jacking off too much. And I got to bunk with Dahmer.
Oh,
you know what I mean?
Pissed.
I mean,
he'll be having conjugal visits.
How outraged will I be?
Well, he'll be happy, though.
He'll be happy, but that's why I'm bringing a shovel with me.
Yeah. Well, he won't be allowed to eat anyone, because that's got to be what hell would be for him.
I was thinking about the afterlife.
Oh, it's your own hell.
Yeah. He'd have to eat Jell-O. Yeah. No humans.
No, he'll be visiting with his family and having conjugal visits. That'll be your hell.
But he doesn't get any hands. That'll be his
hell. Yeah, no elbows.
No, but here's the deal.
I'll be sitting down for Thanksgiving dinner with canned cranberry sauce with the white trashmans every night. That'll be my hell.
I was thinking about the afterlife today, and I thought to myself, you know how we finally sort of figured out figured out things that we can manage with the physical universe? I mean, all these brilliant people over thousands of years have put us into the state where technology is so advanced. Those people are over on the other side now. Can't they figure out what that universe is all about?
Right. And we can't get Copernicus and Galileo to get together
Einstein
or something.
And
put something together.
Send us a message.
Yeah.
How's that part of the universe put together?
Well, true. You got to understand.
They might have moved beyond us.
Codes.
They might be in another universe past that one.
Yeah, but we should be figuring that one out. They figured this one out.
Yeah.
Well, they got eternity to figure that one out.
These guys, they do talk to these people, you know, these spiritual correspondents, I like to call them. They talk to people, they talk to the dead, but just in riddles. Nothing big. Sort of like
just to amuse the dead.
You know when you're on your cell phone and you're in a bad part of the canyon or something?
And it's like, cut now.
That's what it is. I always love that end of it. I just saw a whole thing on like 2020 last week on this. You know, they get the people in the room. Somebody old died. Who? Anyone? Yes, me. Yes, my grandmother died too. Yes, and cancer, heart disease. That's really cancer. Yes, genius. She's 85. Right. 70% of people die of heart disease or cancer. You know, and she's saying now. Let's see, something about a brother, maybe a sister. She says, listen. Why didn't she just tell her what it is? Either you can talk to the person or you can't. What is this whole riddle thing? You know, that it's total nonsense. But I do agree with you, Drew. We've had some of the greatest scientists and the greatest minds pass away over the last several thousand years. They could come back. Even Jesus ain't coming back. He's supposed to come back. He's not coming back.
Just figure out how to master that universe.
But how do you know they haven't? Because we're not in that universe.
But when they talk to us, they don't talk about the technology of the other.
Anderson was screwing around over there. He forgot the F word.
Well, she snuck it in on you.
All right. I agree. And they're probably over there working like a combination, like a VCR waffle maker or something. And I'm sure it's bigger than we could understand.
Yeah, it's bigger than all of us.
They don't need those things because they're in heaven.
No, they need waffles there. That's my heaven. It's waffles. I eat waffles, nothing but waffles.
But you've already established it, and that's not where you're going.
No, I'm going to hell. If I go to heaven, I'm going on a waffle binge. My belief is if they really want to send you to hell, they let you run around heaven for a weekend, and then they send you down there.
Spike.
Give you a little something. Yeah, a little taste.
Back up to the big Waffle House.
Yeah, Monday morning, the alarm goes off, and you're in, you think, I'm sitting there with the bib with a big picture of a waffle on it.
Naked women feeding
my chops, and all of a sudden, a hatch door opens, and I go sliding down to hell. All right, Mike.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're 25.
Yeah, I just want to tell the cast, like, what a great job they do on the show.
Thanks, Mike.
Thank you.
And Valerie, you're fine, girl. I used to watch you when you were on that baseball show that you used to host.
Yeah, thanks, man.
The Fox pregame? Was it the pregame?
Yeah.
Did you ever do any movies or anything?
Done little stuff, nothing exciting.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
All right.
But thank you.
She's single.
Thank you very much.
She is single? Dang. I wish I was you, Drew, sitting over there with her.
Where are you?
I'm in Bakersfield.
Yeah, Drew doesn't wish he was you, though. So.
What?
Bakersfield, not part of California, by the way.
Hey, be easy on it now.
I'm going to work on that.
We got to break California into fourths. We got to get the central, northern, far northern, and southern.
I'm going to do some serious gerrymandering when I'm in charge and start breaking it off because it's confusing. It really is confusing to people the rest of the country. They go, they got some guy coming from Bakersfield. He's got a big... Big plug of chaw on his lip, and he's driving a pickup truck, and I'm like, where are you from? California. Where? Really? California.
He's from Atlanta.
California. Where's that? California. Wait a minute. I thought there was like movie stars, and Robert Urich's from Cali. You're not from Cali. You and Robert Urich are not from the same goddamn place. Or John Forsythe. No way, you two. He's not from California. All right, we will take ourselves a little break. We'll be back after this.
LoveLine, LoveLine. We'll be right back.
Drew over there, Valerie Rae Miller and Richard Gunn are both here from Dark Angel, Tuesday nights, 9 o'clock on Fox. Show is number one hit of the new season. That's what I'm calling it. And it was number one last week. What's on? Gunsmoke? What's it on again?
Frasier?
We haven't watched TV in a while. Is Gunsmoke still on, Drew?
Rifleman.
My Mother the Car. Oh, Rifleman's right. Beat the CBS lineups. My Mother, Car, Gunsmoke,
Lost in Space.
Bonanza, Lost
My
in Space, Space, Amos and Andy,
Gilligan's Island, and that's followed.
I think
the sad thing is
Cronkite
that they're all still
does
on.
The evening news and wraps it up after then the Farm Report. After that, hey, now everything's on TV all the time.
Yep.
But I remember, and I know you're old enough to remember this, Drew, that back, well, first off, yeah, it was great when people signed off.
Yeah,
I mean, the station signed off.
Every
night, yeah. Like, you knew you were staying up too late when you saw the Blue Angels.
Yeah, and a flag, a picture of the flag.
Right, and every...
Some stations need to sign off.
And then it would go... go to a pattern, yeah.
Right, and every once in a while, one of them had, like, a poem. They showed like an F-14 fighter, and it was flying up and up, and he reached into the sky. It was like Chuck Heston narrates, and he touched the face of God. And it was like, I was like, listen, I don't need to hear Chuck talking about God. I've jacked off 9 times, ate 14 bowls of top ramen. It's 3:15 tomorrow. I'm strung out. I'm still living at home. I'm disheveled. This sucks. I mean, about touching the face of God at 3 in the morning on a Tuesday night, but you knew you stayed up too late when they signed off. Yeah. And
and it's depressing always, too. It's like,
it was depressing.
Geez. Oh, man.
It was
twofold. It was A, no more programming for you to watch.
Right.
And B, the party's over. I mean, hey, it's like when they flick the lights on at the nudie bar. They turn the house lights on. It's like, oh, Christ. Yeah. What night? What Monday night? Oh, Jesus. Yeah, you feel bad. You start to sober up. You got to go home. But there also used to be really horrible shows on at 4 in the morning and stuff. They'd start reprogramming. Yeah, but I mean, they had Farm Report and stuff, like Regional Farm Report. There used to be a show called Let's Rap. bad 70s forum shows. Like, we have Roberto Zapatas Escuela, Alonzo Conchita Escuela here. She's representing the Grape Pickers Union. And on our right, we have some chick like 40-foot afro, very proud, you know, sitting there. And then we got some white guy over here. And they're all sitting around this bad white coffee table
mostly,
talking about issues.
Was it old B-movies?
Yeah, Mostly.
Do you know what I like that comes on right now? Infomercials. Yeah. I can't watch them, though, because they hook me in.
No, Adam. That's Adam's thing.
Do you like them, too, Adam?
Hey, I bought a Wonder Mop.
Oh, my gosh.
I bought a mop. I don't even know what to do with a mop. I bought a mop.
No, it's like the mop vac? Because I wanted that, and I didn't order.
Oh, the mop vac? No. I'm looking into one of those steamer things, so.
Where you can close the vegetables in?
Let's take some calls.
Yeah.
There we go.
I love that.
By the way. In what universe does your shower ever get as bad as they do on those commercials? You know what I mean? Yeah. They open a shower door, it's like a goddamn chia pet in there. It's like, what does this person do? Does that have like a stroke or something? What's going on? I mean, listen, I'm a bachelor. My shower's not pretty, but I don't have mushrooms growing on the side of it.
It's also it's like some sort of limestone runoff.
Yeah.
It's like a cave.
It's an atrium.
Yeah. It's like there's a stalactite coming up from
it's
the ground.
Bat cave.
Of lime.
All right. Rachel?
Hi.
Hi, you're 20. What's up?
Hi. I just called to let you know that my husband and I love Huell Hauser.
Oh, boy. It's life in the fast lane. Because you're up pretty late for a Huell Hauser fan.
I heard someone mention him. I'm like, I have to call him and tell him that we watch Huell Hauser.
Grand.
She's slap happy.
Yeah.
And beautiful.
Huell's great to watch. He's been KCT for 150 years doing the L.A. beat out here. He's great. Well, the good thing about Huell is you can go get something to eat or take a dump in between words. You know, not miss anything. A lot of shows, you'll miss half the show. Huell,
we even have a favorite episode.
What is your, what were they, a food?
We went to go visit like some llama-like animal in Somar.
Oh, he once saw some. Yeah, he does these back. He just tours people's backyards. Great. what do you call it? Huell, that's called a hibachi. A hibachi! What do you do on that? Huell, we barbecue on it. You
We need to get him on the show, don't you think?
Oh, yeah, so he can kick my ass? That guy's like 6'6".
He's big.
He's got guns the size of a pro wrestler.
Yeah, Ann's working on it.
Boy.
Go, Ann.
Huell, this is wonderful.
Yeah,
wonderful.
Love him.
but listen, Rachel, you've seen him tour the food factories. That's
okay.
When
my husband just mentored, he's all, did you see the episode when he went and ate Menudo?
Yeah.
And he was
It was a big
the
Menudo.
The band or the food?
No, the food. It was a big Menudo cook-off.
He's really adventurous.
Apparently, there's some pretty big controversy in the Menudo schools, which is there's the red Menudo and like the white Menudo. It's great. Yeah, that's fantastic programming.
And I also live in sunny Burbank, California.
All right.
3 months.
All right, you need to kill yourself now.
And 3 parking tickets.
Oh, yeah. They're right on top.
You're going to get
the boot.
I know.
At least they got that airport. We forgive Burbank everything.
Yeah.
Because of
thanks, Rachel. You know, it's great about that boot they put on your car. Yeah. I was just talking about this with my partner, Jimmy, the other day. It's like, you have left your car here for 6 months. We're putting the boot on it. Well, oh, great. Now it's going to be there for the rest of its life.
Yeah.
It's like, it's ironic that they're actually immobilizing something because it has not been mobile.
No. They tow it when you have the boot on there.
Oh, eventually they tow it.
Not even eventually. If you leave it for a weekend, I mean, this happened to me once, and they tow your car, within a couple of days.
But it is ironic that they render something immobile because it wasn't mobile.
Make it more immobile.
Right.
Jake,
that's
real quick.
Right.
We got just a second here.
You got a broken leg? Yeah. We'll break your other leg.
Jake is 14.
Yep.
Real quick.
Sporadically, my testicles hurt.
Yeah.
Just for no reason.
Both of them?
Well, yeah.
Or does it seem to be on one side more than the other?
Both.
Simultaneously.
Just for no reason. I'll be walking around and it'll start hurting.
Something's wrong with his testicle?
You ought to have a doctor look at that, because sometimes you can get torsion where they twist and they can cut their own blood supply off, and it can be a real serious, actually an emergency situation. And there can be inflammations and other things that can cause this, hernias and things too, can be painful sometimes. But it's not nothing. It may be nothing, but it needs to be assessed before you can assume it's nothing, okay?
All right.
It's just not a doctor. It's not a big deal.
I have another quick question real quick.
Nah.
Yep.
Just about, for Dr. Drew, about can tobacco be picked up by UAs?
It could be. Yes, it routinely is, in fact.
What? What's a UOL?
Nicotine. Urine toxicologist.
Oh, boy. This guy's a 14, for Christ's sake. What's he doing?
Well, it's testing.
Hey, Jake.
Yeah?
14, your nuts are on fire, you're chain smoking, you're getting tested for drugs.
I'm not smoking, just chewing. I live in a hick town. I just chew a little bit, and I'm just wondering if they can pick it up in UAs.
Why are you getting your drug tested? Why are you getting your urine?
For sports.
At 14?
You get cancer in your mouth.
The doctor check your balls, too.
And it's really common to get cancer in your mouth. I'm from Texas, and I know so many people that got it like that, chewing.
Yeah, and it ain't pretty.
Nicotine is picked up in the urine, so.
All right, easy on the dip there, Gene.
And nobody wants to kiss.
Are you in California?
No.
Good. Stay out. All right, we'll be back.
Back in a minute.
Hi, this is Brendan from Wheatus, and you're listening to LoveLine on 94.7 KNRK.
Oh, yeah. All right. That is it. I want to thank Valerie and Richard for coming in here tonight. Dark Angel, everybody.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Our pleasure. Good to see you guys. Tuesday nights, 9 on Fabulous Fox. Good luck. Thanks for coming in. And congratulations on the show.
Thank you, man.
Everclear tomorrow night, everyone. And until next time, Adam Crowley for Dr. Drew saying mahalo. Mom, I'm so mad at you. I am so mad at you, Mom.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station. The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.